Yeah, so I'm Mike Nowacek from the Ruhr University in Bochum, Germany, and I would like to take you today on a journey into the molecular world of photosynthesis. But first of all, I would like to thank again the organizers, Ilka and Nick, for giving me the opportunity to be part of this very nice CERNO online seminar. I will start with a brief overview about my recent activities, and then I will focus on our latest work, the structural insights into photosystem II assembly. So, cyanobacteria, so these are fantastic organisms, and I'm particularly interested in them because they perform oxygenic photosynthesis. And we are working with a thermophilic cyanobacterium, Thermocytococcus elongatus. It grows at a temperature optimum of about 45 to 50 degrees Celsius. And the main reason for us to work with this organism is that you can isolate really stable protein complexes. The genome is sequenced for quite some time. And in principle, you can also do genetic modifications with this organism, but it's a little bit more tricky compared to zygnocystis, for example. And we grow our cells in this 25-liter photobioreactors to have enough starting material for our protein preparations. Because we are interested in the molecular machines of photosynthesis, so the membrane protein complexes that are actually responsible for the light to chemical energy conversion in photosynthetic organisms like the PS2 complex, the cytochrome B6F complex, or photosystem I. And we have biochemical preparations for all of these membrane protein complexes because we want to study their structure and function, but also the biogenesis and adaptation of these cyanobacteria membrane protein complexes. This is a general scheme of photosynthetic electron transfer. It starts with the light-driven oxidation of water by photosystem II. And the electrons are then further transferred via the plasoquinone pool, the cytochrome B6F complex towards photosystem I. And here another light-driven charge separation is necessary to generate NADPH at the end of the chain. And at the same time, a proton gradient is built up, and this is used by the ATP synthase for the synthesis of ADP. And with this, we have the two major energy carriers, ATP and NADPH, which are then used mainly for the fixation of CO2 in the Kelvin-Benson cycle. And but there is also an alternative electron pathway, or there are many alternative pathways, but this one is one of the major alternative routes, so-called cyclic electron flow. And here the difference is that only photosystem I takes part in this. So electrons are transferred back to the plasoquinone pool and then to photosystem I to generate this cycle. And by this, only ATP is generated. And this is a regulatory mechanism, the ATP-NADPH ratio dependent on the metabolic state of the cyanobacterial cell. And there have been different routes proposed, and we were particularly interested in one specific route via the so-called photosynthetic complex I. Because this is structurally and functionally related to complex I, for example, of mitochondria, involved in the respiratory electron transfer, but there are specific differences to this compared to the photosynthetic complex I version. And it's present in cyanobacteria, because in cyanobacteria, you have both processes in one membrane, so respiratory electron transfer and photosynthetic. This is a combination, so to say, of parts of both pathways. It was not much known about this complex when we started to work on it. It's a very efficient proton pump. So it pumps 4 protons per 2 electrons. And this is one of the general interests in this complex one, yeah, to understand the molecular mechanism of the coupling of the electron transfer with the proton transfer. for the synthetic version, it was not really much known about this complex. So we started to isolate it and tried also to solve the structure by X-ray crystallography, but we never really got a sufficient diffracting crystal, and therefore this was not really successful. But luckily, I met Jan Schuller a couple of years ago, and he is an expert for cryo-electron microscopy. And this was really a game changer, and it's a fantastic technique, yeah, because now it's much easier to solve structures of these large membrane protein complexes compared to the crystallography approach. And he is a real expert for this. At that time, he worked at the Max Planck Institute for Biochemistry in Munich. Now he moved as an independent group leader to Marburg with an Emmy Noether grant to establish his own group. And but we are still collaborating. I will come back to this later. And so together we were able to solve the first structure of such a photosynthetic complex one. And we could see then all the photosynthesis specific subunits in this complex. And the whole story was published 2019 in Science. And for example, yeah, in this animation, you can see these photosynthesis specific subunits are colored in green, and they are mainly located in this hydrophilic domain of the complex, which is related to the electron input or electron transfer towards the complex. Because this is one of the major differences between the photosynthetic version here colored in green and the respiratory version in gray, that this whole domain of the respiratory complex is missing in cyanobacteria and plant chloroplasts. Yeah? And this means there is no NADH binding site and no oxidation of NADH to transfer electrons in the complex. So the alternative pathway is via ferredoxin. And this makes a lot of sense, yeah, because this is directly generated by photosystem one in photosynthetic organisms, and donates then electrons to complex one in this cyclic electron transfer process. And so we have shown this in vitro, and we could also measure the specific rate constants for each step in collaboration with Pierre Sétif in Saclay in Paris. And by this, we could also show that the electron transfer from ferredoxin to complex one is a very efficient process and fast process. Okay, another interesting that there are also alternative version of this complex one in cyanobacteria, and they are involved in carbon concentrating mechanisms. Maybe you are familiar with this, that there are several transporters in the cytoplasmic membrane of cyanobacteria that transfer bicarbonate into the cell. Yeah, so it's a transport to enrich the internal bicarbonate concentration. And then the bicarbonate diffuses to the carboxysomes. And in the carboxysomes, there's a carbonic anhydrase located, and this converts the bicarbonate back into CO2, because this is the substrate for the Rubisco. But there is also some leakage of CO2 from the carboxysomes, and this is recaptured, or that's at least the idea, by this alternative version of complex one. And because you cannot just express, for example, a carbonic anhydrase in the cytoplasm, because this would just convert the higher amount of bicarbonate back into CO2 and not CO2 into bicarbonate, yeah, because the concentration of bicarbonate is much higher, which means we need some more energy, yeah, to catalyze the reaction in this direction. And this seems to be somehow done by this alternative version of complex one, or so-called NEH1 complex. That's the reason why we were also interested in this, yeah, to understand the mechanistic details of this. And also in this case, we were able to solve the structure of this carbon concentrating complex one, again, in collaboration with Jan. And what you can see here in this animation is that there is a new novel module attached to the tip of complex one, And this brings the new function, this carbonic anhydrase function. And because we have an atomic resolution here in the structure, we can also see all the structural details. And it turned out that the corresponding protein, it's called CAPA, is a novel type of a carbonic anhydrase that was not described before. It's a very special type. Yeah? So the active center is located here close to the membrane part. And you always find this zinc ion in carbonic anhydrases, but it has a different coordination here in the CAPA protein. Yeah? For example, an arginine residue is involved, which is quite unusual. Yeah? And so also by additional molecular dynamics simulation, we got some insights into this into the reaction mechanism of this protein complex, but there are still a lot of unanswered questions and things to do here because we are far away from understanding all the details that are going on in this complex. Another very interesting observation we made in this structure was that we found the chlorophyll. Usually this is not a green complex because it's not light driven. But at the very tip here, close to the CAPA protein, we found a density that fits nicely to a chlorophyll molecule, and it's close to a beta-carotene. And this is near to the active site in the CAPA protein. So we don't know what this means. It could be just an artifact due to the solubilization of the complex with our specific detergents that we extract also chlorophyll somehow that is just sticky and attached to the complex. But it looks a little bit more structured, I would say, so that it might have a specific function. And one idea we had that it might be involved in some kind of light regulation, because also this would make a lot of sense, yeah, to have this complex light regulated. But this is pure speculation at the moment. We have no further evidence for this. And also here, we need more work to understand this in more detail. We are also interested in the application of photosynthetic electron flow. And one idea is to use isolated photosystems in vitro. And this is a long-term collaboration with several people, for example, Wolfgang Schumann at the Ruhr University in Bochum, because he is an expert for this electrochemical cells or setup. And what we are doing here is that we use our photosystem preparations to immobilize the isolated photosynthetic protein complexes on electrodes. And for example, that we immobilize photosystem 2 on one of the half cells of the system, and then photosystem 1 on the other half cell. And then we generate an artificial electron transfer from water, from the water splitting reaction of photosystem 2 to photosystem 1 here. And by this, we can generate, for example, electrical energy. Then we have a kind of semi-artificial biophotovoltaic device here. And we can also couple enzymes at the end of the chain, yeah, to make a kind of in vitro catalysis. And so, for example, we can add here an oxidoreductase, yeah, to convert a specific substrate into a product, or we can, for example, couple a hydrogenase to generate a fuel. Yeah, it's a very nice playground. Yeah, you can exchange all the parts and you can do a lot of you can learn a lot from the systems. For example, Wolfgang Schumann, he developed this redox active hydrogels. They allow a non-diffusion dependent electron transfer from the photosystems to the electrode surface. And by this, you get a much higher efficiency compared to a diffusible mediator, for example. Yeah, so we can optimize and control all these different parts. And so we are far away from a real application, but I think we can use this to learn a lot about the individual parts of the system. And we had also several nice publications in this field. But we are also using whole cells for catalysis, and so for bioconversion, let's say. And here we are not working with isolated proteins. Here we try to express recombinant oxidoreductases in cyanobacteria, yeah, for a specific conversion of a substrate into so-called biotransformation. And this is also a long-term collaboration with Robert Kurist. We first met at the Ruhr University, but now he's a professor in Graz. And he is an expert for this type of enzymes. And our starting system was a very well characterized enzyme. It's a so-called N-reductase, which is NADPH dependent, old yellow enzyme, YQJM, that reduces C-C double bonds. And with this, we had the first proof of concept that was published in 2016 in Angewandte, that we can use actually these strains for bioconversion, and that it works quite well in this light dependent process. Yeah. We are trying to further optimize this. This is now mainly done in Graz, mainly in the framework of a new project for the BioCut, which is coordinated by Robert. Okay, so these were a general introduction into my work, but now I would like to focus on this on the structural insights into photosystem II assembly. And here I will start with an introduction into photosystem II, because I think this is a really amazing and fantastic enzyme, because it's the only enzyme that catalyzes the light-driven oxidation of water. So it's very special. It's usually a dimer. Here you see the pseudo-symmetry axis, and you can find more than 20 subunits per PS2 monomer, so quite huge complex, and you have a huge number of cofactors present in this complex. There are 35 chlorophylls, 12 beta-carotenes, pheophytenes, plastoquinone, a B-type heme, a C-type heme, non-heme iron, and the so-called oxygen-evolving complex. And this is the very unique feature of photosystem II, because this is responsible for the water oxidation. Yeah? So it oxidizes water, and the four electrons are then stored in this cluster, which is made of manganese and calcium that is bridged by oxygen. And oxygen is released. Yeah? So all our life depend on this enzyme, yeah? Because this is the source of oxygen in the atmosphere. And I think this is pretty amazing. And this is a highly difficult reaction, yeah, because you can easily generate reactive oxygen species, peroxides, and to get this really efficient, nature has created something very special. And a lot of people are trying to understand this in detail, how this works at the moment. But what you can also imagine is, if you have so many different subunits and so many different cofactors, that it's quite an effort to assemble such a machine. Yeah. So how is PS2 biogenesis coordinated? Yeah? You have all the different parts, and they have to find together in the right way to get a functional machine in the end. And I really like this analogy to the cars, because for cars, we have developed this concept of an assembly line. Yeah? So you start with a single part, and then you attach more parts, and then you get modules, and then these modules are combined in this assembly line. And in this case, yeah, you have here the robots that are responsible for the attachment of the particularly part to the growing machine. And you can find something similar also for photosystem II in cyanobacteria. So here we have an assembly line. Yeah? It starts with individual components, and then they are assembled to so-called modules, and then the modules are combined, and at the end you get a functional complex. And what you can also find are these robots. Yeah? So we have proteins called assembly factors, which are involved in this process. Actually, there are now more assembly factors known than PS2 subunits. We have more than 20 assembly factors now identified. So the whole community has identified it, and the number is still growing, yeah? Because it's a quite complex process. And each of these factors is involved in a specific transition, yeah? So at a specific time point in the assembly process of photosystem 2. So how are they defined? They are not part of the mature complex, because then there would be a subunit. But these are proteins, also called auxiliary proteins, that interact only transiently at a specific transition with an intermediate or a pre-assembled PS2 complex. So we are interested in this intermediate complexes and modules, and we specifically would like to have a molecular characterization, yeah, to understand the molecular function of these assembly factors, because we have now this map, so we know in which transition which assembly factor is involved, but we do not know the precise molecular function of the assembly factor. Yeah? We know that it's there and that it's important, but in many cases, we do not know what they are actually doing and what they are good for. And this is something we are trying to target now for many years. But the problem is, of course, that they are only present in very low abundance, these intermediate complexes, due to their intrinsic instability. So the cell doesn't want to accumulate any of these intermediates. Yeah, they should form the active complex, and therefore they are intrinsically unstable and only present in low amounts. And therefore we have to do some tricks to get also preparations of these intermediate complexes. And we were particularly interested in one specific transition. It's the attachment of the so-called CP43 antenna protein of photosystem 2 or module, because we have already other subunits bound here, to the so-called RC47 complex. And we have the central D1, D2 proteins assembled together with CP47 and several small subunits. And these two are combined. And then we have a complex that has all the important parts of the membrane intrinsic proteins, but we still do not have the water splitting activity. So we have a complex that is already photoactive, yeah? So there's charge separation going on, but the water splitting activity is missing here, yeah? Because this comes with the attachment of the so-called extrinsic proteins and the incorporation of the manganese. Yeah? And so we were interested in this particular intermediate here, because two assembly factors are involved, PSP28, which comes with the RC47 module, and PSP27, which comes with CP43 module. Now to enrich these complexes, we deleted one of the small subunits in photosystem 2. It's the one that comes latest into the complex. It's PSBJ. So it's just a small protein. But if you delete it, this leads to an accumulation of a PSP27, PSP28, PS2 intermediate. Yeah? So this was published already in 2012. And you get a complex here with these two assembly factors. And it accumulates to quite huge amounts in this mutant. And for our structural work, we attached additionally a strap tag to CP43 to facilitate the isolation of this complex furthermore. And with this, we were able to solve the first structure of a PS2 assembly intermediate that contains these two assembly factors. But it turned out that we have one more new protein here in the structure, which we named PSP34. And again, this was a collaboration with Jan Schuller for the cryo-EM part, and also Ben Engel and Till Rudak were involved in this. And Yeah, so we have published this as a preprint last year on BioArchive, but just a couple of days ago, I got the final acceptance letter of Nature Plants that this work is not also accepted here for publication. And what you can see now here, this is PSP27 attached to the CP43 module. Then we have in red here, PSP28 on top of the complex. And then in pink here, this new protein, the new assembly factor, PSP34, that is just a single transmembrane helix with a long N-terminal tail. And this is an overview about the structure. Yeah, so we have the RC47 complex part with PSP28 and the CP43 module with PSP27. And the overall structure is not completely similar to the mature PS2 complex. Yeah? So it's slightly different because this CP43 module is not finally attached in this intermediate. Yeah? It seems that we have stabilized here by deletion of PSPJ an intermediate complex that somehow stucks in the assembly process. And luckily, we were not just able to solve the structure of this PS2 intermediate with all the three assembly factors, but at the same time, we solved also two more structures. And one, this seems to be clearly an artifact, yeah? Because here we find PSP28 and also 34, but PSP27 is missing. But we know from PSP27 that it's only loosely attached and it gets quite easily lost. Yeah? And we think that this is a product of this process. But we found also another complex without any of the assembly factors. And this was actually quite nice because this is an internal control for us that we can clearly assign structure differences caused by the binding of the assembly factor from other things, yeah, like for example the missing PSPJ subunit, because this is also not present here, and by this we can clearly assign these the structural differences, and we can compare it also with the fully assembled PS2 monomer. So this structure was published 2010. It was a crystal structure, and so we can see now all the differences here that are caused by binding of the assembly factors. I will show it first in this little movie, what happens to the total part here of the CP43 module. Because what you can see here, it's not in the final position in the beginning. It's a morph video between the P328 bound state and the unbound state. And in the unbound state, you can see that something is going on here in this region. Yeah, and it seems that this module clicks into place after the release of PSP28. So to the role of PSP34, the new assembly factor. Again, this is a top view here. You can see the single transmembrane helix with the long N-terminus. And we confirmed actually the presence of this subunit also by mass spectrometry. This was again a nice collaboration with Julian Langer at the Max Planck Institute of Biophysics in Frankfurt, because he has a very special instrument. It's a Malitov type instrument where you can directly generate fragments of these small proteins. Yeah, so you don't have to do any digestion. And usually the small subunits are quite hard to identify by mass spec. But with this instrument, it was quite nice. And so we could confirm the presence here also based on this information. And what we also did was a pull-down experiment with tagged PSP34. So we attached a strap tag. We mainly use the so-called twin strap tag here. To the PSP34 protein and pull the corresponding complexes. And what we isolate then is exactly this RC47 complex and the subsequent PSP27 PS2 complex. Yeah? So the exact transition that we have stabilized in the PSPJ mutant, what we can see in the isolation of PS2i. And so from this, we know that this protein is an assembly factor and this, that it is specifically involved in this transition of the RC47 complex, which was a quite nice result here too, that fits to the structural data. And so what might be the role of DSP34? I mentioned sometimes, you know, this long N-terminus. And if you compare the structure now with mature PS2, you can see that part of the binding site is usually occupied by the so-called DE loop of the D1 protein. But in our assembly intermediate, this site is occupied by PSP34. And so we think that the role of this protein is to assist PSP28 in the displacement of this D1 DE loop. It's majorly due to the binding of PSP28. I will come to this on the next slide, but we think that PSP34 assists this process. So what is PSP28 doing? It's bound on top here of the RC47 module. And you can nicely see here that PSP28 has this beta shield structure. And this is extended now by the D1 DE loop. And this structure is not present in the mature PS2 complex. It's induced by binding of PSP28. And this causes major structural rearrangements in this region here of the D1 DE loop. And what you can also see is that on the other side of the beta sheet, this is also extended by the C-terminus of the CP47 subunit. We confirmed this also by NMR spectroscopy. And this is also interesting because this gives some information about the directionality of the assembly process, yeah? Because it has to run in a certain direction. Yeah? You don't want to deassemble PS2 during the process, and you don't want to interfere also assembly factors with the active PS2 complex. And here, this C-terminus is bound to the surface of the complex after release of PSP28. And by this, it blocks the binding site of PSP28. Therefore, it cannot bind afterwards anymore. And this, we think, creates also the unidirectionality of the process, for example, in this case. Now, to understand the other structural rearrangements, I would like to introduce you first into the electron transfer inside of photosystem 2. So I mentioned already this oxygen evolving cluster, but the light active part takes place here in the central chlorophylls, the so-called reaction center chlorophylls. Here, after light excitation, charge separation is generated, and the electron is transferred via pheophytine to the so-called QA quinone molecule here. And then the electron hole is filled by a nearby tyrosine residue, and this is again reduced by the oxygen evolving cluster, which stores the electrons from the water oxidation. And now the electron is further transferred from QA to a second quinone. This is a mobile quinone, and after it accepts two electrons here, it's protonated and leaves into the membrane and donates the electrons to the next complex, to the cytochrome B6F complex. And what you can see here, this interesting structure between the two quinones, because here you find this so-called non-heme iron, and it coordinates a bicarbonate ion. And this is quite interesting because Bill Rutherford showed in a study a couple of years ago, or actually it was 1 or 2 years ago, that binding of this bicarbonate has also an influence on the redox potential of QA. So if you remove it, you change the redox potential here, and then you have less forward electron transfer and more recombination with the system. So the electron is transferred back to the reaction center, and in a safe way without creation of any reactive oxygen species. That's the idea, also. That's the reason for this recombination mechanism. And this makes sense, yeah. If the final electron acceptor bicarbonate is missing, then this mechanism shuts down PS2 right at the beginning of the electron transfer chain. And now in our intermediate structure, also a lot of rearrangements are going close to the non-heme iron here. So what you can see here is the QA molecule, then this is QB. In the mature structure, in the assembly intermediate, we do not see any QB because the QB binding site is not present. So it's completely distorted by the structural changes induced by PSP28. And you can see here, for example, this residue is usually involved in coordination of the head group of the quinone. It's at a completely different position, and therefore we have no QB binding site here. That's the first observation. And the second one is related to the bicarbonate that is present in the mature PS2 complex, because in our intermediate structure, it's replaced by a glutamate residue here, which is usually located at this site in the mature complex. But in our intermediate, it displaces the bicarbonate close to the so-called non-heme iron here. And this was really surprising for us when we saw for the first time this structural data, because this coordination of the non-heme iron resembles that of reaction centers of non-oxygenic photosynthetic bacteria. So they have a glutamate residue here and no bicarbonate. And it seems that so during biogenesis, we have here a PS2 complex that can do charge separation, but which has no oxygen evolving capacity because this part is missing. It turns somehow in a structure of a non-oxygenic photosynthetic bacterium. Yeah? So I think this was a quite surprising observation for us. And so why could this be important, or why is it interesting? And so what we have done is we analyzed this recombination kinetics here, and also we analyzed the system for the formation of singlet oxygen. This is a very reactive oxygen species that is generated in photosystem II, but you can avoid this. For example, by extended recombination and this on this so-called safe way here, and that is seems actually the case for our intermediate, because we could show that the formation of singlet oxygen is reduced in this intermediate compared to a control sample where we just mimicked the situation in the complex by removing of the extrinsic proteins. So we think that this is the actual role of PSP28, that these structural changes are responsible for a protection mechanism during the assembly process of photosystem II until the water splitting activity is activated. And this brings me to the last point, to the role of PSP27. This assembly factor binds in a remote position here at the loop E of CP43 at the luminal site. So now we are on the other side. Here's PSP28, but here is PSP27. And it turned out that it has little overlap with the other extrinsic proteins that are present in the mature PS2 complex. So after incorporation of the manganese and then attachment of the extrinsic proteins, if you look at the overlay, PSP27 is located in a part where it has only very little overlap with the extrinsic proteins. And this was a long debate, and still is a debate about the role, because the initial idea was that PSP27 blocks the binding site of PSPO to somehow create a time window for the incorporation of the manganese into the cluster binding site, that it's not not closed by PSBO before the manganese is incorporated. But due to our structural data, I think this idea is questionable because we see only very little overlap here. Yeah? So it might reduce the affinity of PSBO, but I think we need more experimental data for this. And there is also no direct contact of PSB27 to the OEC. It's quite far away from this region, but it might have an indirect effect. So it could stabilize a specific conformation of this loop, which is important also for the coordination of the manganese cluster. Yeah? So also residues here of CP43 of this loop are involved, at least here in the second coordination sphere of the manganese cluster. And so it might be that it stabilizes here a specific conformation that is important then for the incorporation of manganese. And the other idea could be that it's also important to stabilize CP43 in the unbound state. Yeah? Because if you have a flexible domain here, it might be attacked by proteases, and PSB27 might be important to stabilize it prior to attachment to the complex. What is actually going on at the manganese binding site? We also had a look on this part of the structure. And as we have a quite high resolution here, we could see another density in this location here. And it looks like that there is a single cation bound at the manganese site. And most probably it's the first manganese, yeah? Because from spectroscopy data, you know, for a long time now that there is a so-called high affinity site where the first manganese is bound during the assembly process. And then in this photo activation, after this, the other manganese are incorporated, and that there is a structural change in between, which is a rate limiting step of the whole process. And you can see it already here that there are some differences in the D1C terminus, for example, if you compare it with the material structure. I think you can better see it in this animation again. And we think that these are the structural rearrangements of the D1C terminus that are responsible for this rate limiting step after incorporation of the first manganese here. So that's at least our idea, but also here we need more data. What is actually going on here at this specific transition? Okay, with this I would like to summarize this part again. So this PS2 assembly intermediate contains three assembly factors: PSB28, PSB27, and PSB34. We have isolated it via twin strap tech. The structure of PS2I was solved by cryo-EM with 2.72 angstrom resolution. The binding of PSB28 induces large structural changes of the D1DE loop, and this has consequences on the QB binding site. It's actually not present in this intermediate, and it replaces also the bicarbonate ligand of the non-heme iron by a glutamate residue. And this motif is found, as I said, in non-oxygenic photosynthetic bacteria. So PSB34 may support this process. And the idea is that the structural changes are related to a protection mechanism to avoid, for example, the formation of singlet oxygen during the biogenesis of photosystem II. And PSB27 seems to stabilize this loop E of CP43, but has only a little overlap with the PSBO binding site in mature PS2. And we find this single cation, probably the first manganese atom in the high affinity binding site during this process of photoactivation of photosystem II. Okay, with this, I would like to thank all my people in Bochum, particularly Jurit Sabret, the PhD student involved in this PS2 project, and of course all my collaborators, particularly Jan Schuller, Ben Ingel, and also Till Rudak for their work in the cryo-EM structural analysis, which is, again, it's really a revolution now for the field. And of course, I would like to thank all my funding sources, particularly the DFG and you for your attention. Thank you.